Helping students and healthcare professionals not just survive, but thrive with a purpose. This is the CMDA Student Pulse Podcast with your host, Bill Reichardt, National Director of CMDA Campus Ministries.
So welcome to another edition of CMDA Student Pulse Podcast. I'm Bill Reichardt, National Director for Campus and Community Ministries here at CMDA. And my guest today is Dr. Trish Burgess.
Hey, I'm so glad to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad you are too. And this is a first for us to have somebody in studio. We were typically doing it over Skype, but you work here at CMDA, so I figured...
Why not?
Let me, to everyone listening and watching, let me give a brief introduction of you, Trish. Director of Global Health Outreach, GHO, which is our short-term missions ministry here at CMDA. You attended the University of Georgia.
Go Dogs!
Go Dogs, that's right. Achieving a bachelor's degree in chemistry and then a firefighter in Athens for 2 years prior to starting medical school at Medical College of Georgia. Did residency at University of Missouri in Kansas City, and you are an emergency medicine physician. And you were that for about, 20-some years?
23.
23 years. And then during that time, you were taking trips with GHO.
Right. I started about 10 or 12 years before I quit, you know, emergency medicine to come here.
That's right.
And then started leading, I think, 3 or 4 years later. So then I was leading a trip a year and then going on another one.
Yeah. So you've been director of now GHO how long?
5 years.
5 years. Wow. It's been an amazing 5 years. context being COVID and so many challenges.
Right. It's been probably the most challenging time for GHO in its history. And a lot of that, of course, was an international shutdown. Mm-hmm. You know, for 14 months, we didn't go anywhere. So, you know, surviving that and just the grief of that, not getting to serve how we wanted to was difficult for our whole team.
Right. Well, that's going to tie into what we're going to discuss because, you were obedient to God's call to bring you here. It did not mean that it was easy and placid and it didn't have any problems. I mean, there were challenges along the way. And even backing that up, you know, God called you to be an emergency medicine physician.
Right.
It was a calling God placed on your heart. Let me ask you, how did you sense that calling? And was it challenging to be obedient to that call once you realized it?
Right. It was actually interesting because I did not start college planning to be a chemistry major, planning pre-med at all. Mm-hmm. In fact, my dream was to be an international journalist. So I still had that desire to travel, but I like to write. So I thought I'd be a journalist. And I actually took chemistry for non-science majors as of my first elective. And I actually really loved it. So I thought, maybe I ought to switch to this. And somehow that instructor really kind of brought the medical side of things out. So by the end of my freshman year, I'd switched to pre-med and just fully felt that God was calling me to that. Mm-hmm. Not that that's an easy road at all.
Right.
It's very challenging. so I knew that I was to be a doctor. Of course, you know, a lot of us start, we don't really know what field, but I'd worked as a firefighter for a couple of years and really enjoyed that. So I knew about rescue and EMS. I'd actually used the jaws of life to get someone out of a car once.
Wow.
So I had the really cool perspective of that side.
Right.
And then thinking about being at the other end of that, waiting for that patient to come to the ER. So I was leaning towards that when I started medical school. I found that first year so challenging, which is when I was really prayerful about, is this what I'm supposed to be doing? And just really, really reassured that, yes, I'm calling you to be a doctor. And just there's so many things about emergency medicine that fit my personality. I'm fast-paced. I like to move from one thing to the next. And I like seeing all the way from newborn babies up to little old ladies. I just have always said those are my favorite patients. And anything in between, I liked critical care and trauma. And I think God gifted me in that because, you know, when chaos ensues and someone comes in distress and everyone's like freaking out and pulling stuff and equipment and supplies and all that, I just get this calm. Like I have to have this tunnel vision to be able to concentrate and think about what to do next or how to take care of them. And it's not something you can generate or create in yourself. So I think it's just a gifting that God gave me, which led me into that field.
Yeah, it sounds like God, like you said, gifted you in a manner with personality and temperament and all the things that he's, you know, entrusted to you to be able to function, I think, in that particular specialty in a way that I think would, you know, what is it, the gentleman from Chariots of Fire, you know, when I run, I feel his presence.
Right.
That kind of idea. When I'm, you know, you felt like, this is what I was created to do. This was very much why God placed you here. But then it doesn't mean, though, that it is an easy life or path.
Exactly. Even you know, becoming a doctor was certainly, I questioned that, yeah, that first year. I think a lot of us do, when we realize how hard it is, how much we're expected to memorize. And almost everyone doubts themselves a little bit through that. But even in your career, because you find yourself, so I'd learned emergency medicine. I was EM trained, so mm-hmm. I had all the skills. I knew the procedures. I had the logic, but but it's not just that. And mm-hmm. I find it interesting. I think that's why they've always called it the art of medicine.
Yes.
Because you can know all the facts, but if you're not a good communicator, you're not going to be very effective. Right. But also, I think part of our obedience is a heart matter.
Yeah.
Because that's how this whole topic came up previously, was that I was really looking at the obedience and what God expects mm-hmm. of us. And he really doesn't honor our obedience if we're doing it begrudgingly.
Okay.
He expects us to honor him and to be obedient from our heart.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you put that into medicine, mm-hmm. that's when it gets really hard, because you can't just be clinical and cold and tell somebody your child's dead, or, mm-hmm. you know, see someone who's been doused in gasoline and set on fire
mm-hmm.
and just clinically, you know, do your thing. Your heart is engaged.
Yeah.
And if it's not, then you're probably not in the right field, or you're not doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that engagement in your heart in hard things really can cause significant suffering in us. Because I grieved a lot through my career.
Stay with us. More Student Pulse podcast in just a moment. Vignettes, initiatives, innovations, and education. Join us for the annual VIE poster session at the 2024 CMDA National Convention. Any healthcare student, resident, or fellow is eligible. Submit your abstract before December 3rd. It's your chance to showcase your research on a wide variety of healthcare topics and be eligible to win prizes and recognition. Enter now at cmda.org/VIE.
Join us for the CMDA National Convention, May 2nd through 5th, 2024. Hear from Will Graham, Executive VP of the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. Ashley Chapman, President and CEO of the Alliance for Freedom, Restoration, and Justice. Senior Pastor of Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship, author and world-renowned speaker, Dr. Tony Evans. Dr. Lydia Dugdale, Director for the Center for Medical Ethics at Columbia University. Dr. Far Curlin, Trent Professor of Medical Humanities, Medicine, and Divinity at Duke University. And Reverend Stan Key, our 2024 conference Bible teacher. Don't miss this opportunity for the lowest price. Register today.
I know, you had shared some of that, and I'm not expecting that you'll share all the stories, but are there some particular stories that would help our listeners understand that, you know, from the outside looking in, it can look like idyllic, it can look like it's charmed, you know, everything is, you know, comes together, but when you're in the middle of it, there's really, like you said, suffering in the middle of obedience.
Right. It's people see it as, wow, what a great career. You really make a difference. You're changing lives,
mm-hmm.
saving lives. I'm like, but you don't see all the losses and all the grief that you have to share with somebody. My first experience was really my first year out of residency and my real job as an emergency room physician. It was a 2-month-old baby
mm-hmm.
who clearly had been abused.
Mm-hmm.
And not just a little bit, but her entire head was covered in bruises, yellow to purple, so different ages,
mm-hmm.
so different time periods. She had hundreds of scratches on her arms and legs, cigarette burns, a human bite.
Uh-huh.
And so I think some of that is that humans do this to other humans is what really impacts you on it. But, you know, you grieve the loss of that. And she came in actually dead. We didn't even try and resuscitate her. But there are those you're trying to save. So there's that hope component to it, that you're really working hard to save them, and you think you might, and then you don't. Or even just talking, like another child had died, and I had to go tell the family. And you know, I was walking down this hall towards them, and we try and put them in a family
mm-hmm.
room, But they wouldn't go in. I mean, they were just so agitated and really distressed, and he had flipped his four-wheeler and it landed on him. And so they knew that it was serious, and so they were freaking out as a mom, dad, and a 13-year-old sister. And I'm walking towards them to tell them we had tried but didn't resuscitate him, that he was dead. And the dad, just so anxious, I could just see the fear in his whole expression. And he kept asking me as I'm walking toward him, is he dead? Is he dead? And I wanted to wait till we were in the room so they'd have some privacy. But then he kept asking me, and I just felt like, how cruel is it to not answer his question when I know the answer? So I nodded because I was still like 20 feet away, and then just the screaming and wailing, and everyone was witnessing it. So it was out where people. So then I was like, you just don't know sometimes. You don't have the answers to stuff like that. God, should I have waited? You know, just those things you question yourself. And I really found myself, you know, in the time, you really have to focus on what you need to do. So you're able to push that aside, focus on what you're doing. I think when it really came to a head was just a few years ago when I had a woman who had a big cancer in her neck and was beyond treatment. And a lot of times they die because it erodes into a major blood vessel and they bleed out. And she had come in with an episode of bleeding that had stopped. And EMS were like, it's a lot of blood, you know, and they were still in the room. And so I was talking to her about what she wanted done. Do you want resuscitation? Do you want to be intubated? Do you want CPR? All those things we have to know. And she didn't want any of that done. She knew it was too late, you know, that it was too progressed. And then she started bleeding and bleeding and bleeding. And so, you know, I'm reassuring her, put my hand on her back, so I'm letting her know we're with her. We're holding a bucket for her, trying to get her hair out of the way. It's just pouring out until she passes out. And then she died, gosh, probably in a couple minutes. And we're all just standing there. Because we weren't doing anything. Yeah. You know, you didn't have that, push that aside, I'm going to focus on what we need to get done. You're letting it happen. So it was that first time I realized what we go through. Because I guess I saw the shock and the fear and the what just happened on my nurses, on the EMS crew. And so it prompted me to start an EMS Bible study. And at that time, too, studies were coming out about how much we suffer from PTSD.
Yeah.
You know, I think probably police are the worst because they see the stuff that we don't even get to see in the ER. So our obedience, if we're heart engaged in it, I think a lot of times we'll cause some suffering because we're seen with the compassion of Christ.
Yes. And I think it's, you know, a sense of obedience to that calling gives you the ability to persevere in the middle of that suffering. I mean, to hold tightly to the idea that you were called to do this, to be here at this moment. And God has a plan and purpose for you as the physician in this moment with these patients. And it probably keeps you going.
That's a lot of it. And I couldn't do it. I mean, I begged God at one time to let me stop. Like, I just can't take this. And he was like, you are absolutely where I want you to be. And he really, over a couple month period, he just reaffirmed that I have you. I knew you weren't going to be perfect at it.
Right.
But I have you right where I want you.
Yes.
You're doing exactly what you want. And the hard part with all of those is at the time you're busy and you have patients, other things going on, so you can't just like wallow in that. You can't just sit there and grieve and cry with them because you've got to move on. But so then we go home and try and act like we're normal lives and play with your kids and cook dinner and all the time, all this is on you. So I found most of the time my fellowship of suffering was Christ. With Christ was at night. Like I could just, I'd cry myself to sleep or I'd just lay there and just pray and just pray for the family or pray for whatever it was and just really feel like I needed him there with me. And so I really understood the beauty of our suffering in that his presence is there with you. Like I think because it's dark and it's quiet and no one else is around, but you just really feel the presence of fellowship in that suffering. And people don't want to see the beauty of that. They want to just skip past the suffering and go on to recovery mode.
I want to touch on that. And we're going to expand on that in just a minute, but there was a story you told about the older couple. Tell us that story because I think it's going to then dovetail into what you just said.
Okay. And yeah, that was part of reflecting on that, doing this, preparing this chapel talk was what made me really kind of finally tie all this together, and that happened years ago. But so there was an elderly couple. They had had this big family reunion sort of dinner for the holidays. And they had all the kids, grandkids, all age ranges were there. But they were all leaving at the end of it, and most people had parked across the street, but they had parked this couple on a side street. So they were alone and crossing the street together, the two of them, and they got hit by a car. And so they both came in as traumas. I took care of the gentleman, and then one of my partners took care of his wife. Well, his wife didn't survive very quickly. She was pronounced dead. And he was walking, or he wasn't walking, but he was talking and communicating and not critically ill. He had some, probably had some significant injuries, but I needed to get testing done on him. I needed to get CAT scans and x-rays and those sorts of things. So I chose not to tell him right away so that he could go lay still for these scans, and I thought we'd wait till he got back. And so I went into the family room and talked with the family, and they were a lot. They were like 15, because they'd all been at this reunion. So there was a whole gamut of family in there, this little tiny room. And so I'm talking with the family, and there were siblings together. So I think these were, kids, and then the grandkids were there. But one of them in particular, it actually was a daughter-in-law, but she seemed to dominate. Mm-hmm. Like, she wanted to manage and control the whole situation for the whole family, which was an odd person in the group. But, you know, they were all letting her. So, but anyway, she insisted that they all be in there when I told them, which I'm perfectly fine with that. I encourage family to be there for each other. So he gets back from a scan. So I went and told the family that I was ready to go in there. And he's laying in the stretcher. And, I mean, you have to know something's up if your entire family comes in with the doctor. So I stood by his bed, like right next to him, hand on his shoulder, and told him that I needed to talk to him about his wife, because he'd been asking about her a few times, and I'd been stalling it. And he just could tell by the expression on my face and just started to cry. And I said, "I'm so sorry, but your wife died. She didn't make it." And he said it was so sad. He said, "I just lost the love of my life." And so I was just letting him cry, and the alpha woman, I called her the daughter-in-law, she just shouldered me out of the way and was like, "Daddy, it's going to be fine. It's going to be just fine. Everything's fine. It's going to be fine. I saw Mama. She looked fine." And we all looked at her like, "You mean the one I just told him was dead?" And she realized what she'd said, and she said, "She's in a better place. It's going to be fine." So she immediately... You know, here he just found out the love of his life had died, but she was already ready to skip through all the suffering and just go right to everything's going to be fine.
Yeah. I mean, we have a suffering servant. We have a man of sorrows who's acquainted with grief, who sits with us, who's willing to sit with us in the middle of that pain and suffering. And yet there's this tendency or temptation to want to short-circuit that, to kind of shortcut that.
Right.
I just need to get to the other side of that, because it's just too hard, and we cheat ourselves, don't we, by not allowing ourselves to process that suffering and to draw closer to Christ in the middle of that suffering.
Right. And I just say all the time to people, there is such beauty. Some of these moments are absolutely precious, and if you just bypass all of that, you lose your chance to fellowship. I mean, I think our true fellowship in suffering is the way we really connect to Christ, because we all at one point in our lives are going to suffer. Life isn't always happy and good. And if you want to just skip that, you won't really truly experience the fellowship of Christ, but also you won't really appreciate the resurrection, you know, and the redemption.
Right. Aren't we glad that Christ did not, I mean, he was pleading to the Father, take this cup, if it be your will.
Right.
But we're glad that he did not skip the suffering. He endured it. He went faithfully to the cross.
Right. And the other thing I think that's just amazing about our God is not that just he wants to be there with us. He wants to fellowship with us in our suffering. But he calls us to do that for him. He calls us to remember, to do it in remembrance, which isn't even just remembering, but to be reliving what he went through for us. So I just feel like there's a God who's so close to us, to humans, because he became one, that not only does he want to be there for us to suffer, but he wants us to remember that and be there with him as he suffered that. We get to be a part of that, even though it's thousands of years later. And I think people are so afraid, our culture is just so afraid of pain, of suffering, that we just try and skip it. But in the end, probably a lot of that is our mental health issues too. You're eventually it's going to catch up to you. You can't just bypass it.
Yeah, no, that's very true. Well, talk a little bit. I know in the chapel message you went in a lot of detail, but let's just even point our focus towards Christ himself and the suffering that he went through on his way to the cross. Can you talk a little bit about that as it relates to, you know, understanding just the depth of suffering and what even Jesus himself endured?
Right. You know, so I did, I wrote on, I was speaking at a Good Friday service in church years ago, mm-hmm. and I've elaborated on it over the years as I've studied the Bible more. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm put this in there too, but what Jesus went through for us mm-hmm. was just so, so much more difficult than we can imagine.
Stay with us. More Student Pulse podcast in just a moment.
Going to continue to advocate for life at the beginning, advocate for life at the end, and advocate for biblical sexuality in between.
Healthcare professionals face a lot of challenges today. The most challenging issue that healthcare professionals of faith face today is the assault to our rights of conscience and their ability to practice medicine according to their own medical judgment.
True to 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 1 through 5, wickedness is increasing. But God has placed you in the earth at this particular time to be His voice and His witness to such a time as this.
So I ask you to join our advocacy team here at CMDA. We want to educate, encourage, and equip our members to be involved in these various advocacy efforts.
But, you know, it just starts with the whole emotional side of it. And I think we tend to kind of blow off some of the things that are mild. But, you know, so he had the Last Supper.
Right.
He knows what's coming.
Right.
And I'm sure, can you imagine enjoying that meal? I mean, it probably was not fun at all. And he's having to talk about who's going to betray him.
Right.
You know, so he's brokenhearted.
Yeah.
And then he's up all night praying.
Mm-hmm.
And have you ever had a sleepless night? It's a long, miserable night. I mean, we tend to blow that off, but that's a lot, mm-hmm. you know, just to have endured that, and then just the angst and that he sweated so much. He sweat blood in his sweat pores.
Yeah.
Hematidrosis. I mean, it's a medical term. I've never seen it. So.
You mentioned that created even a condition of sensitivity in
yes,
his skin. So
yes.
Now he's about to get flogged, and there's all that coming up yet, and he's made himself even more vulnerable.
Exactly. It makes your skin more sensitive.
Right.
And then, you know, it's not just a whip, but, you know, there's all these, you know, leather straps and stones or metal or bone that are ripping and tearing through skin. But you then every blow, I actually saw a patient when I was in Turkey, who he wasn't a patient. He was actually part of the church, but he had been flogged. Mm. He had 39 times. And I saw the scarring on his back as he had healed because he showed it. He had chronic back pain. I think some of it was probably psychological because it's like just, but the scarring was amazing how much there was, you know, as it tears deeper and deeper into the muscles right. and the bigger blood vessels. And then, you know, and then just think about the scalp and, you know, those thorns are like an inch or two long. He's digging into your scalp and being beat on the head. And, you know, it talks about even his beard was pulled off his face, like just like in Isaiah describes that you couldn't even recognize him as a human by the end. And now we don't know for sure because that's prophecy exactly how much, you know, he was flogged, but it had to be particularly harsh given that he couldn't even make it to Golgotha carrying his own patabolum. He just couldn't even carry it. So, you know, he had to have help with that, which tells you it was probably particularly harsh.
Yeah. Well, I think we could probably include this in the show notes. There's an article out there, I think a JAMA article that talked about the intensity
right.
of that
yeah.
we could probably put in there, or any other resources that you think.
Right, I mean, I have my document I'm happy to share with anyone that really describes the physical suffering. In the end, of course, crucifixion is death by suffocation because they just can't exhale enough to take another deep breath, so they end up. And actually, another ER story about that is I actually had a patient who came in the ER one night really short of breath. Like he was sweating, he was anxious, he was breathing really fast, and he said he'd been up all night smoking a crack pipe. This is like a 30-something-year-old, otherwise should have been healthy guy.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, well, maybe he collapsed a lung, you know, inhaling the heat or whatever. But I got an X-ray and he hadn't. So then I didn't know what to do with him. I was like, wow, that's odd. I don't know. This doesn't really fit anything. But he had a little bit of a haze over one side of his chest in the whole left lung, which didn't make sense with the story he had told me. But I didn't know. There wasn't anything else to do. His oxygen saturations were really low. So we just usually intubate them. And once you put a tube down, breathe for them, bagging them, you know, and you put them out, basically they go to sleep, everything calms down. It gives you time to figure it out. But we could not bag him hard enough and fast enough to get his oxygen up. So there's something wrong with this guy. I don't know what it is. I did another x-ray. Still couldn't see any better. Still just this hazy left lung. So I finally said, I'm just going to have to put a tube in this side and see if there's something there I can drain.
Yeah.
So I cut a side in his chest wall to put a big tube in it to drain it. And blood-tinged water poured out like a waterfall. I mean, there were like three or four nurses watching in the room. And we all jumped back. I mean, it was gully washer coming out.
Oh, goodness.
And my thought was, that's what Jesus did. That's what Jesus did. He had this huge pleural effusion in my patient, which is what you get. And when they pierce his side, that's what happens. So it was just like, oh, my gosh, this is what Jesus did on the cross. So it's just one of those moments where, wow, what he went through for us.
Wow. Well, I appreciate you being transparent and just honest about the challenges and the suffering that you've gone through. I think it's good for the listeners, many of whom are students, to kind of hear kind of some real life stories. I have not gone through medical school, so I don't know all that's communicated, but I trust, maybe you can correct me, or, you know, do they get a realistic assessment, as you've really shown it, as that this is going to be a difficult profession? There's going to be suffering, even as one's called.
I think it's one of those things that I don't feel like I had any warning, but I don't know that you can really teach it.
Yeah.
But you're just putting, there's so many different situations you can be put in.
Yeah.
But it's really the emotional impact of it and trying to be there, not just clinically to help them medically, but to be an encourager, a supporter, grieve with them. You let them know people care about what they're going through and that we're not just cold fish in there, you know, like robots, but that we have care and compassion. And if you're going to represent Christ through your life and through your work, your heart has to be in your ministry too. It can't just be a cold, calculated, I know what to do in this situation, but you really have to engage with your patients and the patient families to be the light of Christ in a really dark, hard world. And the emergency departments are very secular, and so it can be a very dark world, but being the light is what we're required to do, and that's obedience.
Yeah, amen. That's a great encouragement. Let me leave you with the last word. You know, maybe there are folks who are going through some personal suffering even now. It could be physical, it could be mental suffering, emotional, it could be relational suffering in some form or another. It happens in so many different forms. What kind of encouragement or exhortation would you give someone listening as they're going through this a time of pain and suffering?
Whenever I've been through that, you know, I've had, of course, my own personal, you know, we all have personal worries and concerns, not just my work, but I really focuses on Jesus. Like, I really just spend time with him. I mean, I just pray, and my favorite prayer is a one-word prayer of Father, and I just open my heart to him, you know, cry if I feel like or whatever, but I just really want him to feel what I'm feeling, to fellowship with him that way, and it will be amazing how you feel his presence. And then bringing the body of Christ around you.
That's a key.
Helping each other through, especially medical students, residents.
Yeah.
Help each other, especially if you know someone's been through a really traumatic patient encounter. Just be there for them. Let them listen and cry and talk about it and just, you know, encourage each other.
Yeah, we too often underplay community. We can be so isolated
and doctors especially, you know, because we're all really independently. We're not working together. We're working side by side.
Right.
So it's a big difference. And then, you know, if you feel like you've made an error at all, which I've been through that too, I'm really suffered feeling like it was my fault. Someone, you know, didn't survive or whatever it is that you might think you might have done. You know, you're told not to speak to anyone about it. And so then you feel like you're going to implode. But you've got to have those people around you, you know, other Christians, which is why I even opened up myself to talk about this in chapel, is because I want people to understand how important CMD is. It will give you that community. Bill works really hard to do that, but it gives you that community of believers that can really understand you're not just clinically upset about what happened, but your heart is engaged in the suffering of what you're seeing. So
this is great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Actually, one more thing, because I mean, it's going to be a hard left turn, but you're here, you've got students listening and watching. GHO, let's just give you an opportunity to say maybe a couple words about that and how students can get involved and what opportunities and resources are available for students.
Yeah, one of my heart cries for GHO is we really, really want to pour into the next generation of healthcare professionals. So we want to be there to mentor you. So we encourage students of all levels. Undergraduates can join us, but especially first year, because you have a little bit of time, spring break or in the summer, you can can come all the way up to fourth year's residents. We encourage you to go on a mission trip. It's a great way to set yourself aside for that week or so to really focus on your relationship with the Lord and how that ties into your career. It gives you a chance to work with doctors who have been there, watch how they transition to talking to someone about their physical health into their spiritual health and how they can move forward, or if they don't know Christ, how they can share with them. So it helps you learn more about making your career a ministry as well. But you also get lots of exposure. You get to shadow. You get to do work in different areas of the clinic. You get to meet people around the world that are believers. And
I mean, it's a sanctifying work. I often say not only are you bringing comfort to the afflicted, but these trips afflict the comfortable, which is often ourselves.
Exactly.
And it stretches us, and God uses it in transforming our lives.
Right. And these trips, I think the reason healthcare is so different and why these trips are so effective is because if I sit down with a patient, I have an immediate, close, personal relationship. They're going to trust me with their most deepest worries about their bodies and things that they'd be ashamed and embarrassed to talk to anyone else about, would never say to anyone else. But because you're a physician trying to help them, you immediately have a connection that there's no other way to get, especially cross-culture, cross-language, all those things. There's this connection that you get just because of who you are and what you do, that the Lord has gifted you with that for a purpose.
Yeah. Fantastic. We're going to put links in the show notes. You can see trips. We didn't mention this, but there's tons of scholarship money. There's really no reason.
Yeah, we have really good scholarships that give half off. So we really, and we encourage all our students to get those. So
yeah, so no reason not to go.
I think they would love it.
I think they would too. Thanks again, Trish, for being a part of the podcast and for again sharing your own stories and the work you do here with GHO.
Well, thank you. It really is a joy.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. CMDA's Student Pulse podcast is a production of the Christian Medical and Dental Associations. The opinions expressed by guests on this podcast are not necessarily endorsed by the organization. CMDA is non-partisan and does not endorse political parties or candidates for public office. The views expressed on Student Pulse podcast reflect judgments regarding principles and values held by CMDA and its members.